Okay, thank you very much, Matti. Good afternoon, everybody, from sunny Brussels. And apologies for not being there physically. It's always better to meet face to face, but sometimes it's not possible. But I'll be happy to answer questions as well at the end if that's possible. And I hope that WebEx can work properly. It's the first time I make a presentation via WebEx, so I hope I don't press any wrong button at the wrong time. The purpose of this presentation, and thank you, Eka, for including that little bit of the process there as well, even though it's not part of Eka anymore, is to show a little bit how this, what the purple bit in Tim Baumer's flowchart is all about. We're really at the very end of the process. And it looks like it's really a done thing, but at the end of the process, it takes its time as well. And I think for some applicants, this is now a reality that it can take a bit longer than expected. So I'd like to explain a little bit how this works internally in the Commission and with the Member States, with our process. What I would like to talk about is, therefore, what is the role of the Commission, this last bit of the process, how that works, and also what has been the limited experience so far, but we have now a little bit of experience that we can share. The role of the Commission is very clearly explained in REACH, in Article 60, Paragraph 1. So the Commission is responsible for taking the decisions on applications for authorization. And there is also a very specific requirement that a draft authorization decision is prepared within 3 months of receipt of the opinions from the agency, so the RAC and the SEAC opinions, and that the final decision to grant or refuse an authorization is taken in accordance with a specific procedure, which we commonly refer to as comitology, it's examination procedure. I will not explain all the details of that, but it basically means we need to consult member states before we adopt a decision. And then maybe very briefly mention there is also a review of authorizations. As you know, the review period is there with a view to a review of the authorization, which can lead to a continuation of the authorization, an amendment, or a withdrawal. And that happens at the end of the review period, but also it can happen during the period up to the end of the review period if there are changes in the circumstances or in the availability of alternatives. So what is the crux? What is the key element on which the Commission decides upon? Of course, this is not new to us. It comes already from the RAC and the SEAC in the opinions. And you have heard that already many times today, but this is really the crux. So is the risk adequately controlled? Or if it is not adequately controlled, or it is a non-threshold substance, or it is a PBT or a BPBV, or an equivalent concern to PBTs and BPBVs, the question is then, do the socioeconomic benefits outweigh the risk to human health or the environment arising from the use? And in that second route, are there no suitable alternative substances or technologies to that substance? But the authorization decision contains much more than that, of course. The crux is deciding whether what is the reason why we are granting an authorization. But Article 60 clearly specifies what should go into an authorization decision. Of course, the obvious elements are the legal entity to whom the authorization is granted. So in case of joint applications, it would be all the applicants in the joint application. The identity of the substance or substances. We have had already applications for more than one substance. The use or uses for which the authorization is granted. Any conditions under which the authorization is granted. The time-limited review period and any monitoring arrangement. I have included here already from the experience we have had, but although it's put separately, it's actually a monitoring arrangement. This has already been inserted as from the second decision, the on Sasol Hansman, which is an obligation of the authorization holder to provide upon request a summary of the risk management measures and operational conditions of the CSR in the language of the member state where the use takes place. This is a monitoring arrangement that now has become a standard provision in the decisions, which is meant at two things. On the one hand, it's aimed at facilitating, let's say, the life of enforcers so that they have this information in the language of the member state. Because as you know, most of the applications are in English. So far, all the ones we have seen are in English. And that is not necessarily the language of the member state where the use takes place, either because the applicant is located in another country or his downstream users. In the case of an upstream application, they are located in another member state. The reason is also to help the enforcement authorities of the member states, of the downstream users that are covered by an authorization decision, that they have a clear link to what are the risk management measures and operational conditions applicable. What is the process? This is very, very, let's say, schematic, but it has all the elements. We have then first the RAC and the SEAC opinions coming to us, and then the Commission has, as I said, 3 months to have its draft decision. So not the final decision, but to have a draft decision. You might know that the leading role in the Commission for REACH is shared by two DGs, DG Grow and DG Environment. So any draft decision has to be agreed between these two DGs before anything else happens. And this might take some time because it's not, not all the opinions are straightforward. For us, but this is the first step. And then once the two DGs have agreed, then we have to submit it to all the other relevant DGs that have some interest in the matter. For example, it could be that it affects the consumer product, so we have to consult also DG Sante, DG Consumer Protection. It's case by case, depends on the elements of each case who we're going to consult. But finally, the draft decision has to be agreed by all the relevant DGs. The next step is the consultation I referred to before of the member states. This is our REACH committee to whom we submit the draft decision. And this is really where the 3 months deadline is ending, let's say. That's what the period of 3 months should ideally be up to when we have the draft decision ready for the REACH committee. This committee of member states have a vote on the draft, and we should have the majority of member states voting in favor. If there is no such positive opinion from them, then there is a whole procedure of appeal that I will not go into now. And we try to avoid that from happening, but in theory it can happen. And the next stage, the next step is once we have a positive opinion from the committee, a decision of the commission, as based on the draft that was voted at the REACH committee. This is important because at that stage the commission has no margin anymore to decide differently from what has been voted. Only in exceptional circumstances, for example, if there are new developments between the date of the vote and the date of the decision, that could trigger a change, but otherwise we are bound by the version that has been voted in the REACH committee. So I would also like to maybe explain how we work in practice. This until now I explained the theory, what is in the REACH regulation, what is in the procedure, but also I would like to explain a bit how we work on the day-to-day. And the first thing maybe to say is that we are involved closely with all the applications from day one almost. Well, not day one, but day two. So from the moment that the committees start looking at the applications, we are following this closely. And my colleagues participate in the RAC and the SEAC meetings. They follow as observers. The commission is an observer in those committees. We also try to follow the trilogues when they're organized, again, as observers, to really have a good understanding of all the nitty-gritty behind a decision, an opinion of the RAC, an opinion of the SEAC. In fact, this is also helpful sometimes. It can help in clarifying questions that arise in the process. Maybe a clear example was the case of recycled PVC containing DHP. This is one of the pending cases we still have to decide upon. But there the question appeared quickly of whether it was a role of the committees to verify that this recycled PVC was no longer waste, whether this was part of the assessment. Because as you know, waste is outside reach, so whatever is waste cannot be authorized. And there we decided that this is not a matter for the committees to look into, that the application is looked at face value and assuming that it is not waste without prejudging whether it is or not, but that this assessment is outside the scope of the assessment of an application of authorization. Another point I'd like to mention is that we also consider any new developments that may appear after the procedure in ECA that can happen. So we have an opinion from ECA, but if there is any new information that appears, but it has to be new information, of course, that is also something that then the Commission would look into. And what has been the decision-making experience so far? Well, as I think Matti mentioned that already, we have so far 4 decisions adopted on DHP, DVP, and the arsenic trioxide. 3 of them are based on adequate control and 1 on the socioeconomic route. They are all downstream applications, quite a straightforward ones, and all of them, all the decisions adopted by the Commission followed the RAC and the SEAC opinions and the recommendations also with regard to any monitoring arrangements that were suggested. We have now pending decisions. We have a backlog. In fact, we have 16 applications pending, which cover many opinions. As you know, every opinion is per use, so one application may have many, many opinions. A few of them are upstream applications, which is also a new experience for us, and it has proven to be quite challenging. That's why it's taking a little bit of time. And most of them also are under the socioeconomic route. I would also like to mention that, we had this very good lessons learned conference that has been mentioned before back in February, where one of the feedback messages we took in the Commission was that applicants felt the Commission was like a black box. Once they had the opinions, the process in ECA was very transparent. Once they had the opinions, they left into a black box and they didn't know what would happen with them. And because of that, we've tried to increase a little bit the transparency, and we have tried to put as much information as we can on how the dossier is developing in a table that is on our website, on the Europa website, where you cannot see a lot, but you at least can see when is the draft decision likely to be voted in the REACH committee. And we put this there because the meetings of the REACH committee are publicly known. There is a comitology register where you can see all the agendas of the committee and all the dossiers, when the draft has to be voted, it is also published, so you can see the draft decision, in fact. And we thought that at least that would give an idea of where the draft was in the process. So this is a bit like a little GPS to see where the draft decision is in the procedure. I have put on this slide just a picture of one of the first page of this document, which also I have indicated the link to it. And there you can see the name of the substance, the stage at which it is, when it is foreseen for a vote, and also the applicants, and a link to the CSR and to the other documentation from ECA. So I think I will stop it there, maybe just also to encourage you to come to us with questions. We're also part of this procedure. I have heard before that the Commission seems to be very far away on this, and we are not far away, so we are happy to also clarify things, especially once the ECHA opinions have been adopted. We like to explain if there are delays, why, and maybe make sure that applicants are not left in the dark. I think I'll stop here, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.